Namaste. The CYTER, Center for Yoga Therapy Education and Research, has been functioning in the Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth University since November 1, 2010. CYTER is an innovative center. It is a center focusing on salutogenesis, all the causes and the methods to maintain, sustain, and attain health in the individual.
The innovative focus of CYTER is on salutogenesis, the concept of health promotion and disease prevention and management that enables us to work towards the holistic health and well-being for all. All students of the constituent colleges of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth are exposed to the yoga training on a regular basis.
Yoga, the ancient art and science given to us by the Indian civilization, the gift to the entire humankind, is being propagated through Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth in an innovative manner. Here at CYTER, because we are in a healthcare medical institution, we are able to serve those patients who are suffering from various psychosomatic, lifestyle, stress-induced disorders. Patients at our hospital, the Mahatma Gandhi Medical Hospital here, they get the yoga therapy as part of the entire treatment protocol. A patient with diabetes would get the diabetic management of modern medicine, and in addition, the adjuvant therapy of yoga along with it. Similarly, we are doing work in psychiatry, we are doing work in dermatology, neurology, neurosurgery, and of course, obstetrics and gynecology. At CYTER, we are focusing on three aspects: therapy, education, and research.
Yoga is the greatest contributions of India to entire mankind of the world. Recently, the government of India is currently promoting indigenous system of health, including yoga, in strong manner through the Ministry of Ayush.
As a therapeutic center in a medical institution, we have given yoga therapy as individual, small group, and larger group settings for more than 52,000 patients in the last 9.5 years. We have looked at giving them an opportunity to heal themselves, facilitating the self-resilience and self-healing mechanisms through adjuvant yoga therapy. Along with this, we have done extensive research. The research in the form of 19 completed projects, 88 publications, 31 abstracts, and 9 copyrights in the name of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth.
CYTER has contributed to many best practices that are innovative, and 9 of these have received copyright registration in the name of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth. And 3 of them are very close to our heart, because we address the neglected sectors of the population through these best practices. One, for the special children through the Divyanga Yoga, and second one for the senior citizen of the society through the Silver Yoga, and third one to the transgender population through the salutogenic approach to the transgenders. And through these, we are alleviating the problems, many of their problems which have not been addressed through the yoga techniques, through the various aspects and concepts of yoga. We are able to reach out to them through these practices and techniques.
I am Dayanidhi, working as a yoga lecturer at CYTER SBV. I am really happy to doing my PhD yoga therapy at CYTER. Here we have a hands-on experience with patients coming from various departments. Also, we can go into different wards, even ICU, to giving yoga therapy for the various kinds of patients. And here, CYTER, we can build a connection between modern science, allopathy, with the ancient science, yoga.
Looking into the hows, whys, and the mechanisms of how yoga therapy enhances healing, facilitating a state of health physically, emotionally, mentally, socially, and even spiritually. We are very unique because we can offer different yoga therapy academic programs under the banner of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth.
CYTER has started various programs such as diplomas, postgraduate certificate programs, MPhil programs, as well as PhD programs in yoga. In addition to that, in the field of academics, for the first time, we have introduced yoga therapy in the curriculum of nursing college in our institute.
Our therapy programs are ranging from PG certificates in yoga as a therapy, PG diploma in yoga therapy, MPhil in yoga therapy, all the way up to the PhD in yoga therapy.
Hi, I'm Ellie Wilson. I'm visiting from Australia. I am doing an internship with CYTER. I've had many amazing experiences working in the hospital, in the neurosurgery department, neurology, and recently general surgery.
Numerous students have graduated as yoga therapists, becoming the first to come out of this innovative setting in a modern healthcare institution. We have been celebrating the International Day of Yoga right since the first such day in 2015, and every year a minimum of a week, if not 2 to 3 weeks, of activities involving various stakeholders, thus propagating yoga in its holistic manner. CYTER is one of the rare centers in the whole world where yoga therapy is part and parcel of the day-to-day activities of a medical institution. Our patients benefit from yoga. The students of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, whether they are medical, dental, or nursing, they are exposed to yoga as part of their curricular and extracurricular activities. This is truly one of its kind center in the world. And we thank the international community for its support for all our activities. We thank the benevolent management of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, the visionary administrators who enable us to do our best to bridge the traditional system of yoga with modern medicine.
Promotion of yoga in the society, among the students, among the people, and we'll keep our flag of SBV flying very high.
As the World Health Organization is saying today, traditional, complementary, integrative medicine is the future of medicine. And CYTER is striving to achieve that future right today, along with your wonderful cooperation. Thank you so much.
Namaste, vanakkam, swagatam, bonjour, bonjour, no, buonasera, and subrapat to each and every one of you joining us today on our day 5 of SBV IDY 2021 Yogina. Today is another special day. We have two amazing presentations lined up, and before we go into introducing our respective speakers for today, I invite you to join me as we offer a yogic prayer to start the day. Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahanao Bhunaktu Saha Virya Karvavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Om. Today it gives me great joy to welcome the two eminent speakers for today. We have with us for the first session the most amazing son of Goddess Saraswati herself, our dear Dr. Ramareddy Kari Garu. Welcome you, sir, to today's event and the fifth day of the SBIDY celebrations. We also have with us our Deputy Director, Yoga Chemmal, Yoga Telagam, Dr. Meena Ramanathan, who is joining us all the way from US of A, where she is currently put safely along with her family. So we are so happy today because two of our CITER family members are going to be presenting, both of them very eminent, internationally acclaimed experts. And I think it is such an honor when our own team members can not only be team members, as we often say, when it is someone from your home, you often don't know the value. But we at CITER, we know the value, the great value of our family members. And we wish to share such value with the whole world yoga community. Our first speaker for today, Dr. Ramareddy Kari, is one of the most eminent psychiatrists of India. Someone who has written a record number of publications and every day through so many ways sharing with mental health professionals as well as the lay public the importance of mental health in our day-to-day life, and especially in these times of the COVID pandemic where there is the pandemic of fear psychosis prevalent all over the world. And every day, if you look at Sir's Facebook feed, you will see every day there's an article, there's a cartoon, there's a message that will reach the people who need it. He trained many decades ago at the most premier institution, NIMHANS, the National Institute for Mental Health and Allied Sciences in Bangalore. And as an MD psychiatry, did not stop with just being a professor and head at some college, which is the typical route. He said, I will do that also. Then he said, I will start off one of the pioneering private hospitals, Manasa Hospital, that is there in Rajahmundry. And serving thousands and thousands, I don't know how many thousands he has served over the years, but I think he has reached virtually the whole population of that region through his timely assistance done in the humanistic model of medicine. And I would stress that again, the humanistic model of medicine, not just evidence-based medicine, which often is dehumanizing, but the humanistic angle of medicine, he has served so many. Along the way, I think right from his childhood, he was bitten by the bug of obtaining more and more wisdom, as much wisdom in this lifetime as possible. And he started studying the varied aspects that he has studied has even made it into the record books for the individual with the most varied subjects in the educational qualifications. And currently, already having two PhDs, one in education, one in law, he decided to do a third PhD in yoga therapy, and that moment brought him to site of SBV, where he became part of our dear yoga family. Again, at a time and age and seniority, he is a BC Roy awardee, it is the highest award by the medical community in India. He has received the BC Roy Award at such a status where people would say, I will join and you just give me the PhD after a few years. Someone will do the work for me. Instead, he said, no, I'm going to be the best possible student. And currently, I would give him the award for the best and most sincere research scholar we have at CITER. That is his enthusiasm. Enthusiasm to learn. Not just the degree, because people often think, oh, you're just putting degrees. No, he wants to learn. And that is why he has been acclaimed as a son of Goddess Saraswati herself. And as I have been saying over the whole week, we have had all these amazing speakers. And again, I will say, the hallmark of greatness is humility and the capability to share unconditionally in a loving manner. And Rama Reddy Kari, sir, he is an epitome of all of that. So this is a very personal introduction because he has showed me that there is no bar to learning. And where there's a will, there's definitely a way. And we thank you, sir, for becoming part of the CITER family. And at this point, I take the opportunity to welcome you to make your presentation for today, which is going to be bridging the fields of psychiatry and the fields of yoga and yoga therapy. Namaste, sir, and welcome.
Sir, my slides are visible, sir.
Yes, yes, yes.
Namaste, everybody. Today I'm going to speak something on evidence-based yoga in psychiatry. It's such a pleasure that I'm speaking before my Acharya and co-Acharya and so many great stalwarts of the discipline. I welcome you all for this one. Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, such a great university and such a benevolent university which encourages multidisciplinary approaches, and I'm very fortunate to be a PhD scholar here with this university. And I pay my respects to Dr. Geetananda Giri Swamiji, whose tradition is responsible for the whole family, the worldwide global family, to enrich the knowledge this way. Let me pay my respects to our Chancellor, Dr. M.K. Rajagopalanji, and let me pay my respects to Dr. S.C. Parizaji, and my respects to Registrar Dr. Srinivasanji, and my respects to Dean Research, Dr. Adityanji, and my respects to my guru, Dr. Anand Balayogi Bhavnani, who is always kind and who is always very affectionate towards me. My respects to Dr. Meena Ramanathan Madam, who is my co-guide and who is always helpful. Even from USA also, she guides me. And Dayana Diji and my co-scholar, and a friend of mine. Thank you very much, and my respects to you. and all the yoga abhyasis and mentors who are here, yoga abhyasis. Here I find Sangeeta Madam, Shailaja Madam, and Bharataji, Balaji, and so many other yoga abhyasis. My respects to all of you. Let me start my talk. Actually, this particular talk I happened to give previously also somewhere in the yoga festival. Later, I happened to give similar talk when I was given an oration award by Telangana Psychiatric Society. How to integrate yoga therapy with psychiatry? I find some black patch there on the screen. Is there any technical issue there, sir?
Just give me 1 second, sir. I'm just checking it out. I'm not really too sure.
May I come out of the screen and screen sharing and again?
I think. Enter. Yes, sir. If you can do that, I'm not sure where it is happening from.
Similar black screen, I happen to see even yesterday or day before also for some time.
Yes.
Again, I'll try it, sir.
Normally, when we are playing a video, it comes, sir. So,
yes, sir. Possible.
Maybe the video effect.
Could you see my screen, sir?
We can see your screen. Yes, sir. Now it is correct. Yeah. Now it is clear, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Now it is
so clear. It is integrating yoga therapy with psychiatry. This is the aim of my talk today. Menu card is something like, here we have got three components. One is evidence-based. The second is yoga therapy. The third is psychiatry. What is there? What is the connection between these two things? What is scientific approach? Most of the traditional yoga people, they depend a lot on the old scriptures and all, but they don't mind much about the scientific approach. New people, psychiatry and other modern medical people, they insist on evidence base. So what is this evidence? And in what way this yoga therapy fits into psychiatry? That I'm going to say a few words during this time. Is there any need for psychiatry? If psychiatry is having 100% foolproof medical treatment, why should we go for alternate methods like yoga at all? Can yoga fulfill those requirements? If some lacuna is there, that lacuna can be fulfilled with yoga. Is there any issue like compatibility or incompatibility issues? What is the proof? And in future, what are we going to do? Future projections. There are unsolved issues galore. In psychiatry, not only in psychiatry, but in modern medicine, there is management, but no cure. And even if there is cure also, there is nothing like healing. This particular point I learned 2 days back. Partial, but no full recovery. And also the stigma associated with the psychiatric illnesses. Many helpless situations. And also, unlike medical problems, general medical problems, psychiatry involves not only the person, family, society, environment, so many multi-dimensional factors. And here in psychiatry, modern medicine, it is the illness approach, not the wellness approach. Different orientations. There are psychoanalytic people, there are behavioristic people, biologically oriented people. So many orientations are there. And in psychiatry, we learn a lot. Geriatric psychiatry, child and adolescent psychiatry, phenomenology, community psychiatry, psychotherapy, CBT, neuropsychoendocrinology, neurochemistry, so many things we learn. But although we get exposed to so many things, still some dissatisfaction. Okay, coming back again towards the yoga therapy, just I show you some postures. you have to identify which asana it is. Tell me, in yoga, which are the asanas I have presented to you? You may be wondering about this asana, that asana, from your knowledge. But may I tell you one thing? These are all gymnastics pictures. Just gymnastic pictures. As my guru, Bhavananiji, is telling, the yoga has become something like a gymnastics or plastic yoga, or it has been distorted to, mutilated to such an extent that the real yoga is not present. The spirit of yoga is not present in the body of yoga, which is being presented there. So such is the thing. So this particular myth is there even with the medical people who think about yoga. Yoga means putting the body into some twisted posture. Is it going to heal the thing? In what way it is going to help our patients? So this type of impression is there. And we here we have got manomay kosha, which is the key thing. Even in modern medicine also, mind is the key factor, which is responsible for, which is the connection between the body and the society around. Here we talk about the manomay kosha, the imbalances, the emotions, the prana, the flow of the prana through nadis, and the adi of the origin of the disease or illness in the higher levels, and becoming manifested in the form of vyadi through pranamay kosha and anamay kosha. All these things we talk here. Here, yoga therapy offers so many solutions in so many illnesses like schizophrenia, depression, anxiety, psychosomatic disorders, stress disorders, dementias, childhood disorders, and so on. I'm not going to present so many studies have occurred in schizophrenia, depression, and this particular reference is there, particular reference is there. So if I start giving the references, it's going to be a real way, boring thing and all. Indeed, you can find from PubMed or from academia, or just you just key in the word Dr. Anand Balayogi Bhavanani, you'll get a lot of literature about various illnesses and all. And so I'm not going to give really the particular references and all, but the how the approach should be, I'm going to speak. See here, what is the purpose of yoga? The purpose of yoga itself is psychotherapy. Yoga chitta vritti nirodha. The turbulences in the mind, one is going to deal with. So the control over the mind, that gaining mastery over the mind, identifying the turbulences and calming down the thing. So that is the real motto of psychology or psychotherapy or psychiatry. So that's what yoga is meant for. Samatva yoga muchyate, according to Bhagavad Gita, equanimity, stability, harmony, balance, equipoise. So that is the thing which is required for a psychiatric patient. And the utility in psychotherapy, yoga tells about all the modern concepts, long, long back, thousands of years back, which are uttered in the modern terms by, for example, Jnana Yoga. What is this Jnana Yoga? My individual consciousness is, my individual awareness is nothing but supreme awareness or supreme consciousness. It is part of that one. That is Purnam, this is Purnam, this Purnam is part of the bigger whole. So that is the thing. And here in general systems theory of Von Bertalanffy, we are all systems. Yes, human system is there. In this subsystems are there. Trees also having subsystems. Our house is having subsystems. We all form a bigger system, like society. All the societies form a still bigger system. Ultimately, it becomes universe. So systems and systems and systems, subsystems and subsystems. So this is what our Advaita says, our Jnana Yoga says. And also, we are in 2021. Again, we are not going to be stand still. And it is going to, the time will pass on. As the time passes on, we are naturally going to face the ultimate thing like leaving this body. That's going to be the fact. Desensitization for that one, like the abhinivesa, removal of the abhinivesa is practiced through desensitization in the form of Jnana Yoga. Again, it has occurred, sir. Shall I come out and this one, or shall I go to the PDF thing so that there will not be any movements, animations and all, just the plain test will be there?
I think maybe the PDF, sir, because I think the video effect.
Yes, because this is scalar, sir, it has got lot of animations and movements and all.
Yes, all
the gimmicks it has got. So I think I'll come out of this one and I'll go to PDF.
No issues. What we have found is basically that the video controls, when we are watching a video, sharing a video, the video controls come up as a black screen. So there's some video control coming up, which is great. So with PDF, it should be fine, sir. Please, no issues.
Now I have come to my PDF, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I'm talking about the Jnana Yoga. So it produces desensitization of the death fear. And Bhakti Yoga, we have got a lot of emotions. All those emotions can be displaced onto a particular unity, a supreme force like Ishvara. So this can be done. And Raja Yoga, that is the introspection like Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi. These are all concentration and introspection of oneself. So that is what is done in psychoanalysis also, introspecting ourselves and what is the meaning of my behavior like this? Why should I utter like this? So this type of things in Raja Yoga we find. And Karma Yoga, detachment from the emotions, not expecting any results at all, but doing our work, that is the only thing, and the results will come in whatever way it occurs. So the intellectualization and the emotional withdrawal naturally produces better results. So this type of things we were taught thousands of years back. Gita is said to be the best psychotherapeutic tool ever produced in the history. These are not my words. These are the words of Dr. Anantapuram Venkoba Rao, professor of psychiatry in Madurai, not just Indian trained. He has got UK FRC psych he has got, and many US degrees he has got, both certified person. And he's a legend. And Dr. Neki from North India, he's also a foreign return, a legend. Both talked a lot about Gita, that we can never find in Freud or Jung or anybody. And this is the best and eternal scripture, he says. And I was I heard to him only once. But such an impression he left on me, Dr. N.C. Surya, who was the director even before I entered into NIMHANS and spent his life in Pondicherry Aravind Ashram. And see, he was the director of NIMHANS naturally. He was of this stage and ultimately he did not care much for his body, but that was the real stage of Samadhi, we can say. And the promotion of positive physical and mental health and prevention of the disease, promotion, health promotion, and prevention of disease, salutogenesis. I am honestly telling, during these years, 64 years, I did not hear the word salutogenesis. When I entered into CITER office, when sir was talking salutogenesis, secretly I opened my mobile and Google searched what is the salutogenesis. And then I found that, then I pretended as if I knew about that salutogenesis even before. And here in medical college, I was asked to give a talk on yoga. Then I'll be speaking something on salutogenesis, I said. Including the authorities of medical college, what is the salutogenesis, they started asking. Then when I told them, what a beautiful concept. And they should propagate this particular word in our PSM. I do not know why this word has gone, this stem has gone aside. And they wondered and they felt so happy. Okay, this salutogenesis. There are millions of people, American men, practicing yoga in 2016. And again, 4 more million in 2012. In 2020, it was 36 million who were practicing yoga in US. So we can understand. I do not want to go into the details of the statistics. So many millions, 300 million people are practicing yoga across the globe. Japan, 413 growth rate and so on. So I'm not going to speak something about all these things. Again, so many facts, so much glory of ancient ever-shining wisdom. Now coming to the evidence-based medicine, people talk about evidence-based medicine. Many times I give a lecture, non-evidence-based medicine. Even recently also 1 month back, I gave a lecture, non-evidence-based medicine in my Andhra Pradesh Psychiatric Society. Because we have got a lot of wisdom, extra experience, which we do not put into the books also, we don't publish also. Those people who publish in the journals, those are armchair scientists, and they imagine so many things, and they concoct the things and put the things. But the real experience, these were lakhs of or thousands of people experience, we don't put it. So non-evidence-based medicine, we know the value of it. But evidence-based medicine is the thing which becomes the protocol for us. What is this evidence-based medicine? It is the accumulated facts which are given as evidence-based medicine. And luckily, my guru, Dr. Anand Balayogi Bhavanani, having come from this medical stream, MBBS, and at the same time, in the Guru Parampara, we are very lucky to have such a person who can have both combined together so that he can really impress both the modern medical fraternity, and at the same time, he can honor the ancient wisdom. Indeed, actually, these are all animations where both the things combining together and all. Okay, let us have still pictures only. Then, to examine the efficacy and effectiveness, multicentric studies are required. Multicentric in the sense, modern medicine and yoga. There are many places, for example, NIMHANS, here, SPVU, and also SVASA. At so many places, we find this type of things. If we go to PubMed, last year it was, for 1 year, 625 articles are there. We talk so much about PubMed because if it is indexed in PubMed, it's really a great thing. See, similarly, here in this year, it's not 625, it is 687. Yoga therapy, yoga therapy and psychiatry keyed in, and 500-odd articles last year itself. So here we have got ancient wisdom and also the modern thing. We have got science on one hand and the traditions on the other hand. We have to really balance them. Here, the rules of the game differ. For example, the field is there. On one hand, people are holding the volleyball, and on the other hand, people are holding badminton bats. So how to frame the rules? Because rules are different. There are certain pramanas for knowledge. Like we have got Pratyaksha Pramana, the perception Anumana Pramana, Upamana Pramana, Shabda Pramana, Anupalabdhi, Ardhapatti, Aiti Pramana. So all these things we talk about. For example, Pratyaksha Pramana, you know, the perception through the sensory organs. I see the improvement there. I see the blood glucose level coming down. So this type of things are pratyaksha pramanas. And inference based observations like this anumana pramana. Previously he was unable to walk. Now he is able to walk. That means he might have gained some energy. So this type of thing. Because there is some smoke there, I think fire must be there. So this thing also science accepts to some extent. But the upamana pramana, it is only for developing some theory, we use this one. Analogy, for example, a bird uses the wings like this. I think we can develop this model this way for aircraft. And brain works this way. Why can't we use to develop computer this way? So this type of upamana pramanas. And the problem comes here, shabda pramana. We say that Patanjali said this way, Vedavyasa said like that, Vasishta said like this. If Vasishta says, who knows? If somebody says, who knows that he had not hallucinations, he might have had hallucinations. So how can we believe those hallucinations as the truth? We don't believe, unless we have the proof. So here comes the problem. So up to the level where modern medicine accepts, those things only we can take up. Then manomaikosa, as I was telling about the psychosomatics, how far we can prove? See, we also can question them. See, you say that electricity is there in the wire. How can I believe that electricity is there? And you say, you talk about the atoms and molecules are some helium, this one, that one and all. So these electrons and all, I can't see. But how can you say? You say that coronavirus is having a spherical thing and spikes, like who has seen that one? So this type of argument we also can make. But these are all postulations. Science should be objective, not subjective. Fever is there, that is subjective. Temperature 102 is there, that is objective. Systematic, not haphazard. Everything by system. Systematic, one after the other. Logical, the conclusion should be logical. This leads to that one. Cumulative, and in 40 years ago, we found this one. 20 years ago, we found this one. And the accumulated knowledge, we can accumulate and we can add on to that one. It should be transmissible. And the knowledge we gained there, here, can be transferred to Sweden or to some other place. And it should be verifiable. When one is verified that this particular asana is useful in controlling depression, that should be in a position to control depression somewhere else also. It should be verifiable. And also it should be replicable. In whatever condition, it should be replicable. And we have to predict that one also. In future, it is going to happen this way. Because of these features, it happens. And it can be generalizable, not a specific population also. So these are all the things. So when we find these things, we say that it is scientific, it is evidence-based. We have conquered almost so many things in the world. Because of the internet, almost it has become a global village. In medicine, we have got a principle. Less is more effective. Not a person, a doctor who gives 10 medicines in a prescription, that means he doesn't know much about the case. A person who gives specifically only paracetamol, that means he understood about the this one. Optimal point would be there, where diminishing returns will occur when we go for more. And cure is not equal to, management is not equal to cure. And the new point I learned is cure is not equal to healing. Drugs are powerful tools, no doubt about it, but not the only options. We have to think about the alternatives. The other side also we have to think. We should not think from our point of view. Now I'm going to give some certain things which would be applicable for both psychiatry and yoga therapy. When we have a tool, when we have a hammer, everything looks like a nail for us. We feel like hitting on that one. When we know about yoga therapy, we feel like treating everything which comes to our hand. Okay, diabetes, I think I can treat. Oh, arthritis, I think I can treat. I know about this yoga. Depression, I think I can treat. So this is the attitude from yoga therapy. From psychiatrists, we found fluoxetine, wonderful molecule. Try it in depression. Okay. Why not in OCD? Okay. And it is a personality pill, you know, for well-being, you take it. It works. Depersonalization, why not? So this type of, if you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail for you. So many alternatives are there, acupressure, chiropractic, homeopathy, so many. I need not read all these things. So many therapies are there. And why these therapies are still existing? That means the practitioners are there, believers are there. Some people are getting benefit. Why Ramayana people are still reading it? Because it has got a lot of value with it. Somebody writes a novel, it will have effervescence and it will... It will be a hot take for 1 year or 2 years, and later nobody thinks about that one. Similarly, because these have life means, some worth is there. The clinical experience could be defined as repeating the same mistake with increasing levels of confidence. Sometimes we go in a wrong way and we feel that that wrong way is the correct way, and we go further and further into some forest. So we have to be always introspecting ourselves, whether we are yoga therapists or psychiatrists. What are we really doing it? See, always we should not stick to the thing, weapon we have got. Because we found a beautiful weapon called ECT or beautiful molecule called chlorpromazine, we should not stick to that one. We have to be open. So modern medicine is open. And it accepts the thing. That's the reason why in PubMed, so many articles are there. The same weapon cannot work on all the things. We have to improve the design. See, initially we had a particular requirement. For that, we used that particular vehicle. Now we are going to change the model. The design has to be changed. And we should not try to fit the problem into the particular resource we have got. So something odd would be there in every system, and that odd thing has to be found out. So although I'm talking about certain things negative, devil's advocate things should be there so that we can be free from all negative things. So here we have to think about the other things also. The yoga benefits, there have been many reports on improvements in sense of well-being, relaxation. This is my guru's slide only. Sense of well-being, relaxation, quality of interpersonal relations, improved concentration, efficacy, self-confidence, attentiveness, lowered irritability levels, optimistic outlook in life. Yoga reduces basal anxiety. I think the whole topic in one slide, I think we can find. Not only this slide I am using, Dr. Gangadhar, my friend, also used this particular slide in his presentation. See, here the problem with yoga therapy is anecdotal case reports. I know I have, you see, one person came with HIV and I treated with this particular asana and he became negative, and I treated that cancer also with this one. So this type of anecdotal information, science do not act. Okay, case reports, okay, this could be also possible, it seems. I think we can explore this one. To that extent only, case reports are case series. Randomized controlled double-blind studies, so this should be the art of the day. Bandwagon effect. If somebody goes in one way, people keep on saying, this is the thing, this is the thing, this is the thing. They keep on thinking. So we should, this should not be the thing. Placebo effect. When a doctor, somebody comes there in the out of time and asks for a pill, he has given a button, coat button, removed coat button, and asked him to suck that one, keeping it underneath the tongue. He had relief. Then he asked him to spit it out. It was nothing but button. Why did it work? Because placebo effect. Similarly, science is a growing thing. For example, a doctor who thought that this case just doesn't survive at all because such a such a grave malignancy that he is not going to survive. Then this tailor asked him, "What should I eat, sir?" Then the doctor thought that, okay, let him eat whatever he feels like. You take chicken biryani thrice daily and you will, okay, you can enjoy that one, he said. And after some time, he thought that he died. But his son came and this tailor, particular tailor, so he has made this dress for me. Oh, still that man is alive. He went there and asked him. Then the tailor said that, "Sir, you gave me the wonderful treatment, chicken biryani treatment. After taking that chicken biryani treatment thrice daily, I became all right, sir." Then the doctor made a note in his notebook. "Chicken biryani thrice works very well in this particular pancreatic cancer," he has written. And after some time, a barber came to him with the same pancreatic cancer. Then he asked him, "Take chicken biryani thrice daily and you will be all right soon." After 3 days, he died. He came to know about that. Then he made a note in the notebook. "The chicken biryani treatment which works for tailors doesn't work for barbers." So this is the way how science develops, observation on observation. So we cannot find fault. It is an evolving thing. Observations are accurate, but interpretations differ. Truth, but not the whole truth. Everything is truth only, but not the whole truth. Observations are correct only. These are like this one, that one, pillars like and all. So many things are okay, but interpretations are wrong. So many superstitions, how do they develop? Because of association thinking. See, he met with an accident. Then he looked back. Oh, while coming out, somebody sneezed. So that sneeze is responsible for this association thing. Sometime back in my journal club, Dr. Sir was pointing out this kakataliyam. Then I understood that, I should be careful in Facebook postings. So he carefully follows, is it? Even that kakataliyam also he has followed, I thought. See, when the crow, just the association between the crow landing on the palm tree and the palm fruit falling down. The crow is so strong enough to make the fruit fall. So this is the thing called kakataliyam. Tala kaka. So we also sometimes think that this is responsible for the benefit there. So many intervening factors. So this is the thing I kept there. See, having known about the predictions and all doing this. So placebos. This placebos, sham operations. Just pretending as if operation is done, he becomes well. The recent example, Remdesivir, every vial 30,000 or 40,000. So they took the empty vials and filled with saline water or distilled water and gave to some patients, some gullible patients. Those worked. 90% of them recovered with distilled water in the name of Remdesivir. Why should it occur? So placebo effect. Sham things. Our Guruji says, "Press any key, it works." When I ask him, "Sir, which asanas should be practiced for particular thing, or which pranayama should be combined and all," when I ask, really to say, anything works. It should be mindful thing. Whatever you keep mind on that one, it works, that's all. So this is the thing, it works. One third of the people who take anything, it works. One third is placebo effect. That's what I say. In two third of the cases of depression, antidepressants work. But one third is placebo effect only. So for one third only, this antidepressant action is occurring. For that antidepressant effect of one third, we have to think about so many side effects and all. So that is the reason why we have to look for the alternative things also. And this file dryer effect also, we were discussing in our journal club. See, journals tend to publish those findings which are interesting. And they try to keep aside. See, for example, in a PhD thesis, results have come that, no, this has no effect at all. We will be so worried whether it will be accepted or not. Whether should we make some statistical manipulation so that it becomes statistically significant. So this type of attitude is there even with the journals. Dog bites a man is not a news. Man bites a dog is news. And cherry picking, those things which are interesting only will be picked by the this one. And in medical things, we have to undergo double blind studies. The therapist has to be blind and the person also. Here in our study, we are facing, if we say that you are going to have a procedure, undergo it. If I say, how do they accept? I have to say that there is one thing you know, yoga therapy, that is so great and all. You must have listened to TVs and all about the greatness of that one. Why don't you undergo that one? If we say that I'm going to keep you in a placebo group and I'm going to keep one somebody there, we do not know which group you are going to have. Will they cooperate? So, and also in medical things, side effects will be revealing that they are in the treatment group. And how can they wait for 3 months or 4 months taking some dummy medicine? Many conditions are self-limiting. For example, common cold self-limiting. Can we say that it is responsible for the therapeutic effect? So these things also we have to think about. And certain things are remitting and relapsing, like SLE, multiple sclerosis, this bipolar disorders, depression, mania and all. Sometimes we get the not only the bouquets, but also brickbats also. After taking treatment for you for that depression, he became manic. Although it is a natural thing, the people think that this is the response for that switching over. So similarly for the yoga therapy also, sometimes we may get. And Hawthorne effect, like any attention paid, whether it is in the form of positive thing, positive incentive or not, it's going to help the people. So the mechanisms are, the criteria should be there. And when we say something miraculous improvement and all, it must not be self-remitting. And a doctor should certify that this particular disease is there. And he had to certify that this disease has gone with this one. Sometime back, an enthusiastic researcher asked me, body dysmorphic disorder, will you guide me? I'll provide some literature. I told her and I sent some literature. After going through that one, this body dysmorphic disorder, do a doctor has to certify? Yes, a doctor has to certify. Otherwise, body dysmorphic, whether it is imaginary thing or real thing, a doctor, a psychiatrist preferably, if not psychiatrist, at least doctor. Otherwise, your research will not be valid. Then I have to think twice about the particular subject she was thinking. So one has to follow the proper criteria. For example, signs of chakras, I'll just pass through. Chakras, we know that each chakra will have some connection with the endocrines, we believe, and how to deal with this one. So we have to keep a hypothesis, Mooladhara chakra, and what is this one, what is the effect of this one, whether menopausal syndromes, it can be helped or not, whether any importance of sexual dysfunctions of the male can be helped or not. So hypothyroidism or thyroid, this is the chakra and so on. I'll just fast go through this one. See, for example, pancreas, diabetes status, before that, after that, any change. The sampling design we have to, asana group or pranayama group and so on. And also some people will be concentrating on the petals of the chakra. Some people will be concentrating on the bija akshara, ram only. Or some people will be concentrating on the goddess or god, the god who is the Adhishtana Devata. So, and Rudra, the goddess Lakini, and Lakini Ashtotram is there. One person would be uttering the Lakini Ashtotram. So, what will happen after 3 months? So, before intervention for six weeks or 3 months, and this one, any effect on various things. So, this is the way how we go about to have the evidence. Then coming to the psychiatry, how the research will go, whether there is any benefit of yoga therapy in psychiatry. See, for example, in schizophrenia, positive symptoms like aggressive behavior, hallucinations and delusions, or negative behavior like dullness, lack of interest, demotivation, apathy, and also, although he was a very bright one, now even the cognition has also come down. So this type of things, whether modern medicines can help in positive symptoms, but not negative symptoms. Lot of research is going on to improve the negative symptoms. And also many, most of the drugs produce metabolic syndromes, body weight, gaining body weight and precipitation of diabetes, menstrual disturbances, all these things, whether we can help. So studies are going on and many scales are also there. Wait list people, yoga practicing people, exercise people and crossing over. So this type of studies were conducted. Single center trials, small sample, non-standardized methodologies, short follow-up periods. So these are all the lacunae, absence of control groups and all. So here, under the SARS guidance and Madam Meena Ramanathan, Dr. Meena Ramanathan, she has designed what group should be there. So we have started here. Already 500 sample we have initially, the initial evaluation we have done and we started teaching them. Neurocognition test, social cognition test, negative symptoms test. Initially we analyze and group one, Surya Namaskaras group. And group two, asanas, assorted asanas, 5 asanas. And group three, pranayamas group. And group four, Omkar Japa. Group five, we have got relaxation things like Kai Kriya and Shavasana Savitri Pranayama. And group six, I have used my own thing and luckily sir did not criticize that one. He has got that great quality. He never utters a negative thing before anybody and maybe he may be chiding his students behind, not in the public, but somehow I am so fortunate not to have this one. This is this I have started as Energizer group, Kapalabhati, Suryanadi Pranayama and Topkarna. And these six groups are going on. Seventh group, some people say that we are Christians. We don't utter Omkara. We just don't have any interest at all. Then why don't you go for basic exercise? This basic exercise may be helpful for this one. So this one. Then group eight, Sarisar group. This Sarisar group, we do not know who are going to fall in this group. That after 3 months, they will come for follow-up. We have already assessed, initial assessment was done. And after 3 months, they will come, sorry, sir, I could not do this one. This time I will be doing this, sir. This sorry, sir group also we will be assessing. And even without any intervention also, whether they have improved. So this is our good control group. The exercise control group is there. No intervention group is there. So many interventions groups are there. I think I have got only 5 minutes. Normal healthy volunteers practicing yoga shows reduction of the neuroticism, anxiety and hostility, and it expressiveness and catharsis and sympathetic nervous system, the tone comes down, reduced physiological reactivity to stress, homeostasis improves, muscular efficiency improves and muscle tensions get reduced and improvement, irritable bowel syndrome because of the anxiety they get it and improvement with yoga and burnout syndrome for professionals and dementias. So dementias, really we feel so bad about the people. Professor of a university coming with the dementia, gradually deteriorating, so helpless situation. And I have been using for the past few months about Sanskrit slokas and Omkara chanting and people say that those are helping. Cognitive function showing significant improvement after yoga, including immediate memory, improved microcirculation, and help in intellectual deficit disorder, so-called mental retardation, and also training the skills for them. And Dr. Meena Ramanathan madam doing a lot of work on this type of disabled children and ADHD. And for depression, Ujjayi, Bastrika, Kapalabhati, Yoga Nidra, and in our psychiatry department of our MD Medical College, along with CITER, studies were done, published. Psychological tests shows that with drugs, clinician ratings are improved, But psychological tests showed significantly greater improvement in anxiety and social adjustment with when yoga is combined. And drug therapy improves depression alone, but anxiety, depression, social adjustment gets improved with this one. And habituations, different addictions, caffeine, alcohol, benzodiazepine, so all these things. Indeed, to control anxiety, we give benzodiazepines. Ultimately, a day come, I am free from anxiety, but don't stop the drug, sir. No, you are not supposed to use that drug for a long time. No, you prescribe that diazepam only, I don't require other fluoxetines and all. So, helpless situation. So, this type of situations are helped by this one. Calming effect, increasing awareness, increasing span of attention, acceptance and adaptability, sense of security, and ECT like subconvulsive seizure. This is the thing which is noticed with yoga therapy. So this helps vagal efferent nerve situation, stimulation, emotion recognition and feeling of well-being. And P300, pro-inflammatory cytokines levels are improved. Brain-derived neurotrophic factor, cortisol production is reversed. Omkar Japa, the help in brain, the National Brain Institute near Manesar, decrease in blood oxygen level dependent signals, Sanskrit effect. So in nutshell, what I say is, there are certain limitations, no doubt, for yoga and current research, but those can be easily overcome. We have to ponder about certain things, like what are the difficulties in yoga practice, in what way? See, for example, this double blind thing, difficult thing. And randomization, difficulty. And another thing is the faith factor, faith in the guru, the God's role, the role of faith in improvement, that also helps to some extent. The non-specific healing effects arising due to patient-therapist interaction, in what way those are helping, whether it is yoga or some other therapy also, those will have the factor. So that those non-specific things. And the time-consuming thing, regular, but this one also, with single session, how hypertension has come down, how heart rate variability is influenced. So this type of studies are being done in CITER. The bias, the dosage, interventions, length of intervention, how frequently they are, how regularly they are doing. So this type of all these things we have to think about. Need for generic yoga models. We have generic yoga model of Patanjali or Bhagavad Gita or so, but we have got so many specific, like a paracetamol in form of so many brands and all. Psychological test performance improved and all. So many names of the thing, people getting confused about the things. And each case, each individual case is a case. Not there is something like as our Acharya says, there is nothing like yogopathy. If yogopathy is there, I think a computer will be there, which will be giving the video for each thing. A computer will be there replacing the doctor and dispensing the drugs. No, it is the human interaction, the guru-chala relationship. That guru-chala relationship, it is a tailor-made technique. So that is what assessment of the person, as our Paramacharya, Gitanandagiri Swami has given the beautiful assessment chart. So that should be the way in which yoga has to be practiced. So the logistics have to be worked. How psychiatry department and how CITER have to work in unison, rather than those are of alternative medicine. No, let them not come to us. And those psychiatry people always throw the cases which are hopeless only. So this type of attitude is not the thing, and that integral approach is well seen in SBVU. Very happy. Many advantages are indoor women, inexpensive, no stigma, no side effects, and all. Biological changes occur during this one. So multicentric studies are required. Integrating yoga with modern medicine is the thing. I think Oh, I crossed 2 minutes. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity, sir. Bahut dhanyavaad.
Thank you, sir, so much. And you don't have to feel about that 2 minutes at all, because you know, we, by the time we gave you the screen, we were also delayed. So you definitely have given so much. I was personally really enjoying so many of your visual messages, because I think as someone who enjoys the visual teaching a lot, I think it was a very beautiful visual teaching, especially the fact that when you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And I think that is a very good message to keep in mind. When you have a hammer, everything looks like a nail. And we have to be very careful, because we as yoga therapists have yoga, we have the yoga tools. We shouldn't go looking for nails every place. And we have to know which nail requires it and which nail doesn't require it. And sometimes certain nails need to be put in the box, not put into the door. And just because there are 100 nails, you don't nail them into the window. So I think this is a very beautiful teaching you have given in a very beautiful way. I'm reminded of Einstein's statement that if you understand a subject, you make it simple. And I think that is a very key message, because you have given in such simple, palatable terms some great secrets for those who have ears to hear and hearts to understand. So I would like to request a few of our panelists to say a few words. I'll start off with Dr. Meena, because then she'll have a short break before she comes back to her session. So welcoming you, Dr. Meena.
Yes, please. Namaste all. Wonderful, wonderful. I was just laughing aloud because it was so humorous. I loved that Sorry Sir group. It was really a new name given to a group. Maybe we need to be actually naming a group that way. But truly wonderful, sir. Thank you so much. Like Anand sir was saying, you know, like lot of learning from those visual slides. You know, like there was a car where there was a huge fat man sitting. He couldn't really fit into that. And a small doorway where the elephant was trying to be going inside. So a lot of visual, you know, like understanding, like superb. Thank you so much. I feel so blessed to have been here hearing you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meena. Because of the technological issue, we didn't have the video effects. Otherwise, I'm sure he would have had the elephant being actually pushed into the door. But we have an issue sometimes on Zoom playing video effects. I have seen that in the past also. So that is what came up. I would like to request Sangeeta to share a few thoughts.
Namaskaram, sir. Namaste, everyone. So happy to be here. And I was, of course, enjoying the visuals, and I have been enjoying the visuals of Rama Reddy sir for a while now. Just really, not just because they are enjoyable, but because they give insight to some concepts that words do not reach, whether because the English language is limited or cultural differences. But with imagery, we truly can grasp some deep teachings. And I also wanted to congratulate you, sir, for the courage to speak up. Because actually, when someone has so much wisdom and so much knowledge, and they also have the degree to prove it, not that we need it, but they have it to prove it, it takes courage to speak up in their field of work, medical field of work, psychiatrist field of work, because there is a stigma in this bridging work that we're all doing in our own ways to bridge, you know, experiential learning, spiritual learning, healing and curing. And for you to have the experience, the professional knowledge, to be able to speak up and be a spokesperson for the whole field, means the world to all of us because it actually opens new pathways and new ways for us and for the younger generations to refer to you, to refer to our paramparai, to refer to yoga, because you paved the way. And so it's fun and it's enjoyable, and that's a wonderful part of your work, sir. And also thank you. Thank you for speaking up and for allowing so many that will follow to say yes, but there is a group of people who have done this research and we can count, we can stand on their shoulders. We were talking about that, standing on giants' shoulders, and you're providing that, you know. And so thank you for also making this accessible to the youth through your comic-like strips, you know, and that's how the teenagers will be like, oh, I understand that, right? It's not an intimidation for the youth to access this material. So many ways in which you are benefiting this work, sir. So thank you so much, really.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sangeeta. That is so true that when there's a pioneering bridging done by such eminent people, what happens is then it opens the doors for others to follow. And we need that type of, you know, path makers. Not breakers, but path makers. And usually it's tough because it's like shoveling the snow on the highway in the middle of winter. So it's tough so that all the cars behind you can come much more easily. So sir is definitely doing that. And thank you for pointing it out. I'd like to request Shailaja to make a few points here.
So I'm very grateful to have this opportunity. It's really my first time interacting with most of you. So it's been extremely educational and extremely informative. And I spent so much, I've gained so much just sitting here and just listening to all of you. So I think what really struck me besides, I really enjoy listening to Dr. Ram Reddy sir speak because it's so humorous and I'm laughing half the time. And also what comes through is besides your sense of humor, of course, but, you know, is your youth. And, you know, you're like a child really setting out to learn. And this world is just this place of discovery, like, you know, Wonderland and, you know, whatever, you know, your educational qualifications are so immense and vast, but you maintain that childlike learning capacity and enthusiasm to really explore the world and understand it better. And I really salute that because like Dr. Anna was saying, a lot of people would be just resting on their laurels, but you've embarked on this with so much enthusiasm and so much humility. I mean, I think that also comes through so beautifully. And I think you have a very unique perspective, you know, straddling two worlds, the world of science and now the world of yoga. And you were able to give such unique insights and really like, to me, it's like you're really making the path how to go forward because you know how science works. You have all these insights about, you know, what makes science acceptable. And now you're giving the same insights to making yoga therapy, you know, very acceptable and, you know, which would stand the scrutiny of science in the future. And you're really laying the roadwork for that for the future. And like, you know, Sangeeta was just saying, it's really going to be people like you who have, you know, created acceptability of yoga therapy in the future through your ability to bridge that two worlds of science and spirituality. So, I mean, it's really incredible. I truly enjoy listening to you. Thank you.
Thank you
so much, Sangeet, Shailaja. I now request Sri Bharata to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Rama. Very wonderful, very inspiring. You've certainly raised the bar, even without the animations, you've raised the bar on the visuals. It was very, very nice. I have a question. I'm just curious, and I may have missed it in some of the details, but are there any long-term studies of multi-year studies trying to track behavioral changes in patients, in clients over the second, third year or so? To see what lasting effects of some of the yoga therapy has had. Thank you.
Yeah, in SVSA and NIMHANS, they are conducting years together studies and follow-ups. NIMHANS is the place where psychiatry, neurology, neurosurgery, and many other non-medical sciences also, like psychology, social work, nursing, and all multidisciplinary institution. There they have started the Department of Integral Medicine. And there is a professor also who has done psychiatry and also course in yoga. And the past director, he did his DSc in yoga. So he was responsible for development of the thing. So long-term studies are being done. And in SVSA also, the studies are being done. And why not our SDV also? Already they have started, our sir started with our PhD senior scholars and all. What he says or what I believe is, PhD work is not the thing which should be over. The work has to be extended. Indeed, I thought of asking my sir, see, I have registered in CTRI for this particular study. I wanted to continue the same population for years together because they will be sticking to me only. Can I continue the same thing or should I register again? I thought of asking him. Indeed, your question is a supplementary question towards my sir. But the long-term studies are being done in India.
Right. Thank you.
The lacuna of inadequate data over a long time, I think, has been one of the shortcomings of yoga research, because everybody does a short study, gets their paper published and stops it. So very few people take it further. And I think with Dr. Rama Reddy, sir, he has an opportunity to take it for a long time, because the people who are participants in his study are going to be with him for an extended period of time. And I think that with some modification to CTRI, I think we would be able to later on extend it. I think it would be possible. So I'm looking forward to that manifesting. Thank you so much for that question. I'd like to ask Yogacharini Devasena, who's here with us, to say a few words at this occasion. Yeah, unmute Pananam, sir. And unmute. One second. Yeah.
Namaste, sir. Namaste, everyone. I'm very happy to listen to you. I mean, not really listening, learning again, like others said. And there's a lot of work. It just shows your shraddha, your sadhana in each and every sliders in your, you know, it's really amazing work that many research and many things going on. So it's going to help many people, because we are facing many problems coming, new problems coming up. So people are going really like mad, actually. What's the problem? This have this problem, that like that is many things. So it's really your work going to really help each and everyone. Again, already it's helping. I mean, it's going to help a lot. And it's really amazing, mind-blowing to see your work, your even the small things you take and put very, that shows your shraddha, really. Mind-blowing, really. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Devasena. Kind words. And maybe a few comments from Balaji and Daya, just so that we complete the full group. Yes, please.
Namaste, sir. So it's an honor to listen to your presentation, because when I tell about yoga to the modern medical people, I face a lot of criticism. So you are a big support to our yoga and one of the strongest pillars. So thank you for being there, sir, because I have faced a lot of criticism. When I speak about yoga and yoga therapy to the medical community, there was a bit of demotivating things that happened, but after you and this supporting yoga better way with psychiatric value, it added so much weightage to our yoga and yoga therapy. So thank you, sir. Thank you very much. And regarding this flu oxygen, I had a very good experience. Sir, we had a very good experience regarding the flu oxygen drug actually recently. And the chicken biryani thing, I relate with this COVID treatment, sir, because every 3 days or 4 days, the COVID treatment, the protocol was entirely changing. And I love that you just compared it in a very well, sir. And the way you thought that the doctor who prescribed less drug knows many things, actually, because I got that knowledge before coming into the clinical practice by my guru, Dr. Anand Balayogi. He just told me, listen to the patient. That itself heals them. So I just make it in my each and every day practice. And my wife used to say, "You are I feel sorry for your patients because you are speaking a lot to them." But I feel the satisfaction when I do that, actually. So once again, it's a great honor to listen to your speech, sir. And thank you for the support. And thank you for being an inspirational example for us. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So beautiful, Bala, very true words, and the one who knows will know exactly what to do. The one who doesn't know will do 25 things at the same time. It's like aiming for the mango on the tree. The one who knows how to throw the stone, they need one stone for one mango. But then what happens is people who don't know, they'll take 25 stones and throw it. Some mango will fall and then they say, I got it. Kaka Thaila story will occur there also in a different way. So thank you for that. And yes, Daya, maybe a few words from your side.
Namaste, sir. Yeah, actually, Ram Reddy, sir, is an asset for a CITER, actually. So we actually learned a lot from sir. It's really nice to have you with us, sir, as a scholar. And you are actually a background guide for us, actually. So you are a research scholar, but you are, from you actually we are learning so many things, and even in our journal club also we are learning so many things, how to arrange, how to do research, all those things. And regarding this today's topic, it was amazing, sir. So even if they are, it's actually the topic is evidence-based yoga in psychiatry. Even any audience, any speaker, if they know psychiatry or if they know yoga, if they don't know yoga, if they don't know psychiatry also, it will be a reachable thing for you. What is the core of the topic? So you have spread the message to all the people, whether they know yoga or not. So that's the you can actually simplify it. So what in your speech, if the person is so knowledgeable, they can able to give the single direct dosage to them, as said. So so in your speech, it is we can able to realize that. So you are so keen to the topic which was given to you, and it was really reach the all the audience, those who are in the Zoom, those who are in the Facebook. Really, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Daya, for that very beautiful, pertinent point. And with this, we thank you, sir, for this excellent presentation that was mind-opening, heart-opening, soul-opening for so many, and truly creating a path for others to follow in the future. One of those truly great sons of Mother India, and we are truly blessed to have you with us at CITER, at SPV, and as part of my Geetananda Yoga World family. So thank you, sir, from the bottom of my heart. I now go on to introduce another. So I now go on to introduce one of our CITER founding members, and that is Dr. Meena. Because you heard Sethuraman sir talk about CITER with such affection. And the reason that such affection exists for CITER is the amazing work that has been going on since day one, which was the 1st of November 2010. So 1st of November 2010, when CITER officially began, and Dr. Meena was the only person who had to take care of stuff. Then we were lucky at that time, Dr. Balaji was doing his internship here. So he was co-opted as the yoga instructor even while doing his internship at the college. Then we brought in another yoga instructor, and it was about 3 years later that I came into the picture. Now, from day one, or rather than day zero, I was part of it because sort of I was asked to help start it. And so that's how this whole process came in. But I always like to say that the energy that Dr. Meena has put into CITER is a maternal energy, an energy that a mother puts into the creation of the child. And so many challenges have been there. And despite the challenges, especially in the beginning, when being a non-medical person in a medical institution, you often are looked at as an outsider. And you don't really fit into the scheme of things because you're a non-medical person. And so initially she used to go to different departments and struggle and to get people to be referred. And then people would be like, you know, don't do it and why do it and all that. So big struggle to establish CITER in the beginning. Once I came, it became a bit easier being a person who's, you know, sort of both Indian Yoga Association and Indian Medical Association member, you sort of bridge it. But the initial years, the struggle and the impact on so many participants. I have seen people who would have committed suicide throw away the poison, the pills they had bought to commit suicide. I've seen them throw it away in the dustbin after having that 45 minutes to an hour talk with her. So I have seen the impact on people's lives. I've seen people who had dropped out of jobs, going back to the job and today being at the height of their professionality in the universities outside. And I have seen people come back with families years later. So I have seen the direct impact, and I am not talking about her being the first person to have a PhD in yoga from Pondicherry, which is a great achievement. Not about her capacity to translate all these yoga teachings into Tamil for so many, despite not having done Tamil in her school or college, she does an amazing job at translating. But I think what has been the most important part is whatever she has done has been wholehearted. And because it is wholehearted, it has broken through the barriers. And she has faced so many barriers in her life and broken through them. And this is why I think the power of transformation that I have seen manifest in her over the years, knowing her now for about 20 years, I have seen that transformation manifest through her. And that transformation is then reflected in everyone who comes into her orbit. So she's going to be talking about some of the pet projects we have at CITER and the way we have reached out to underserved population, people who normally don't get yoga. Yesterday, I was asked a question in an interview. Has yoga become an elitist activity? Has it become an activity that is out of the reach of the common person? And I said, well, maybe the yoga industry has done that. But here at CITER, yoga reaches everybody. Everybody who seeks yoga, they get it. And even if they don't seek it, we go and seek them out. So with those words, I'd like to request Meena to go forward on her presentation. And again, as usual, I'm sure she will give us thoughts to ponder on and give us an example for so many to follow. Namaste, Dr. Meena. The screen is all yours.
Thank you so much, sir, for those kind words. Just one thing is that whatever I am today, it is only because of you, because you are the role model that I try to copy, I try to follow. So whatever it is you. That's it. So thank you for those wonderful words. Whatever it is, a pat on the shoulder is always very encouraging, especially from your teacher, from your guru, from, you know, like whoever you think of as the role model. Such nice words coming from them is a big, big, big encouragement for me to do more. So thank you so much, sir. Whatever it is, the credits are yours. We owe it to you. I would say we, because all of us are in the same boat, not just me. There are so many there. And without much ado, let me try to share the screen. Host disabled. I think you have to make me a co-host. Can I? Yeah. Yes. So is my screen visible, sir? Okay. So again, Vanakkam, Vandanam, Swagatham, good morning to you all and a good night to me. It is 1:30 here, so I have time till 2:30. I had my coffee because otherwise I would be falling asleep now halfway through. So that I don't fall asleep, I had my nice hot cup of coffee. So it is always a pleasure and a privilege to be representing CYTER, Center for Yoga Therapy Education and Research of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth. And you have all been listening to all this, you know, CYTER over these few past, you know, from when the Yoginar started. So many words, I mean, so many informations about this. So you must all be a little curious. Aren't you all a little curious as to what is CYTER all about? What is this CYTER? So if you have the patience, I will just walk you through as to what CYTER is all about. And, you know, like so many eminent speakers who have discussed all this, especially on salutogenesis, which is the topic. And CYTER has been celebrating Yoga Day ever since, you know, 2015. And we always celebrate it in a grand manner, spreading over for 2 weeks or so also, reaching out to as many as possible, especially during the Yoga Day times, because everybody wants that awareness program or something or the other to do with Yoga Day celebration. So we try to reach out to as many as possible. So here it comes. What is CYTER all about? And how do we do, you know, like enhance wellness through our outreach activities? So if you're all with me, yes, good. There's no other go, you have to be with me, right? So CYTER, as we all know, has been functioning since 2010 at Mahatma Gandhi Medical College and Research Institute over a decade now. And thanks to the farsighted vision of our Chancellor, Sri M.K. Rajagopalan sir, that since inception, for all the support that they have given, you know, like to CYTER for whatever we are today, without that support, we could never have really, you know, had stepped ahead at all. And CYTER is also, to the best of our knowledge, the only university-based yoga therapy school in India to receive the member school status of IAYT, the International Association of Yoga Therapists of USA. So we focus on three different aspects at CYTER. So the first one is yoga therapy, next is your education, and then third is research. So yoga therapy for helping the patients to recover, you know, like combining the traditional yoga therapy along with the modern medical care. So that is what is happening. It goes hand in hand together, work in tandem. It's a beautiful combination so that the patient gets the holistic benefit, getting treated medically as well as the other complementary therapy so that the healing is complete. So that is the biggest advantage at CYTER. So any patient who comes here to register will be sent to the respective department. They will meet the doctor, consult them, and then they would be referred to CYTER with the proper diagnosis, with the medical diagnosis. They come to CYTER, and at CYTER, we have created an assessment tool based on Swamiji's 12-point assessment, Yoga Chikitsa Anukrama, and we have also copyrighted this. So based on the medical diagnosis, and this is the diagnosis which is based on the 12-point program, like for example, the gunas, the doshas, what is their lifestyle all about, etc. I don't want to go into it because this itself will take 1 hour. It's such an extended, you know, discussion. But the basis is on the Chatur Vyuha model. You know, Heya Hetu Hana Upaya. So we go into the root cause. After talking to them, we'll be able to assess. So the final part would be the Upaya, where we write out, we consult them and write out a few techniques for them which would be helpful, which could be modified as we talk to them after receiving their feedback. We would be modifying the therapy schedule, and that would be taken forward along with them. And the second aspect that we focus upon is educating future yoga therapists. So again, competent medical fraternity people are joining. We have Balaji, Dr. Balaji here, who's completing his PhD now. So like that, medical fraternity people, we have so many from the dental college, the nursing college, who are all interested in doing yoga therapy and hopefully PhD also. But the courses that we offer, starting from certificate and then PG diploma and MPhil and PhD in yoga therapy, all, you know, like the students, it is a much sought after course, because one good thing is that if they get the hands-on training, it is not just the theoretical knowledge about yoga therapy that they get here, but hands-on training. They visit the wards, they go meet the patients, and then apply whatever the therapy schedule is there, and then try it out. Is this okay? Is the theory working on them? Is the therapy working on them? Or do we need to modify it and then change the schedule? So there are so many questions that come up, which could be addressed only if we directly interact with the patients. So that is the biggest advantage at, CITER, all the students are getting that exposure. And they all are after they complete the course, the much sought after course, they are placed in very, very good places. And the third aspect on which we focus upon is the research angle as to how and why of yoga, creating, the qualitative and quantitative research evidence for the application of yoga as a preventive, promotive, rehabilitative and curative therapy. Again, as an adjuvant, along with the medical standard medical care, yoga therapy is given, and it is not just the yoga therapy, but an adjuvant also. So that is more important being in a healthcare university. And we have like 132 research papers, around 15 books and compilations, 7 chapters in national and international books, invited chapters, 48 abstracts to our credit. And a lot of interdisciplinary studies going on. CITER has collaborative activities with, that is one big advantage. Another thing is that we have under the umbrella of SBV, we have a nursing college, we have a medical college, we have a dental college, we have SIDRIF, which is an advanced nodal research center, which is a center, interdisciplinary research foundation, which is a nodal center for research. Advanced research is happening, molecular level, genomic, research studies are happening, and AHS, Allied Health Sciences. All of them existing under the same umbrella in the same campus, and all of them get access to yoga therapy. So that is the biggest advantage here. And all of them correspond with us, come to us. One is for yoga therapy, self-experience. And then, when they do the higher studies, they come and collaborate with us on, and we have so many projects that are happening right now. And what are our clinical services? That every day we have daily OPD consultations. Like I told you, the referrals that are being sent from the various departments of medical college, those patients, and then individual group therapy sessions happen. All the master health packages of SBV has yoga therapy as part of this. The consultation goes on. All the inpatient admitted in the wards, they get yoga therapy, and the post-operative wards. I don't know whether this is happening at any other place, but it is happening at, SBV. That post-op patients, we get referrals from them and we go into the critical care unit or the ICU, and, yoga therapy, sort of breathing techniques are given to them. Pranayama is given so that their healing is enhanced. And so far, we have had more than 70,000 participants getting benefited through our center. and the other services, including, you know, all the medical, dental, like I told you, nursing, AHS students, through the Yoga Abhyasa program, get sessions, you know, like many, many sessions. It is not just one or two sessions. Each of them have a timetable on which, based on which we keep giving sessions to them, and all the faculty and staff of SBV, including the low, ground level staff, the cleaners, even they, that level, we take that up to, you know, like the women staff, the men staff, the attenders, whoever it is, name it, and they have a session. That too, on a regular basis. It is not just one session a year or anything like that. It is kind of a weekly basis, rotational basis. They keep coming and they have the sessions going on. And apart from all this, we have the outreach activities. And other specialized services, now because of the COVID times, we have, our hospital has been named a COVID center. And, the COVID patients admitted in our hospital have a daily yoga therapy session conducted by the instructors. You can see the representative sample of the photos here. You know, like the male ward, the female ward, all of them getting a yoga therapy session. And, like I said, all the staff members and palliative care and psychiatry ward, those who ever admitted in the psychiatry ward, they have sessions every day. And I have to mention this, that psychiatry was the first department from where we got referred. The patients got referred to us, maybe because it was, I don't know, it maybe they felt, after a lot of there was a lot of objection, like sir was saying, they considered us to be an alternative therapy. But when they understood that we were complementary, after that, I think slowly things began settling down. Because initially we had a lot of resentment and, kind of objection from them. They were not able to accept the presence of Saiter in the middle of a hospital along with the other medical departments. So that was a big problem for them. They were not able to digest that fact. But later, slowly, they understood that we were just a complementary aspect. And so then, now it is, everything is after, especially Anand sir came and settled down. So after that, everything has been a smooth journey. And of course, diabetic clinic, just to name a few. And creating wellness in the community. So this is something which is close to our heart again. We try to reach out to as many people as possible through, the workshops, seminars, CMEs that we conduct, bridging the traditional complementary therapy, and the modern healthcare thing. We give regular yoga programs, awareness programs for education department teachers and at Pondicherry University, the students, various schools, colleges, corporate offices, medical and yoga associations. Also, we every year Pondicherry University, government of Puducherry, conducts the International Yoga Festival. And Saiter is a very, very, takes a very active part. Rama Reddy sir has also been there as a part of, as a speaker last year, I think. Was it last year, sir? When things were, good before the COVID times.
Yes, madam.
Yes. So a representative sample of all those, to whom we reach out. So many regular programs being given. And the outreach activities. So you might have been wondering, when is she going to come to the topic, right? And now here we are to the outreach activities. So outreach activities where we try to, reach out to the underprivileged and underserved, the neglected sectors of the local community, especially those who are below the, economically backward, and those who cannot really have get access to yoga if it is being charged. So thanks again to SBV and their policy that all the services that we offer through Saiter are absolutely free of cost, and we do not charge even a single pie for the consultations or for the therapy sessions. Nothing is charged, whether we do it at Saiter, whether we go out and do it, wherever it is, nothing is charged. It is just free. And it is just that, you know, the benefit that they get is what is the fee for us. So that is the only thing we look out for. And thanks to, again, the management and administration of SBV for, you know, holding on to this policy, not having charging all these participants who come to the yoga therapy sessions, especially to these underprivileged populations, because they cannot really afford to have, you know, spend to get the yoga therapy. And the three different sectors that we, you know, like very, very close to our hearts. And that is like, it's like a kid to all of us. And one is like the three different populations that we approach. One is children with special needs, with both the physical and intellectual disabilities through the Divyanga Yoga, the elderly senior citizen through Silver Yoga, and the third one, transgender populations through the third gender yoga. And through the, you know, past decade of work with them, we have come up with a lot of innovations and best practices. So many of our whatever we have been doing have been copyrighted in the name of SBV. For example, you know, all the courses that we conduct are choice-based credit courses, which we have copyrighted. The syllabus has been copyrighted, and nursing curriculum has, you know, it is part of yoga therapy, is part of their curricular activity. So in the 3 years while they are doing their degree in nursing, they have 90 hours of yoga, yoga therapy, which is compulsory part of their curricular activity. They get assessed for that, which goes into their grading also. So that has been copyrighted, and maybe it is a model now that other colleges around the world are following now. And apart from that, you know, with our interaction with the Silver Yoga protocol that we have created for the senior citizens, and the Divyanga Yoga that we have created for the children with special needs, and the third gender yoga for them, and also making yoga fun for special children. So again, the special children, we have a lot of work and activity going on with them. And like I told you earlier, just to name a few again, Yoga Chikitsa Anukrama, the assessment tool that we have created, the case sheet, you know, for assessing yoga therapy assessment. So what are the objectives behind these best practices? The main thing is to empower the underprivileged and support the psychomental and social rehabilitation. So how do we support them during their rehabilitative journey? That is the main purpose of all that, you know, the yoga therapy schedules that we follow up here. And to make them a respectable part in the society, to, you know, resume back, give them back the sense of confidence and self-esteem that has been lost through, you know, down the lane, and reduce the negative traits and tendencies that, you know, they cause harm to themselves or they cause harm to others. So that address that and help, you know, overcome limitations and enhance their coping skills and help manifest their potentials. A few of the objectives. And Divyanga Yoga, as we were saying, it is for the special children. A person's disability, you know, by the naked eye, one look at them and you know there is something is not okay with them. But have we ever thought about, you know, their true potential or what is lying behind, you know, that the odd look that they have? When you look at them, you definitely know that it is a special child. But what lies behind? Have we ever even spent one moment to think about it? What is there something beyond what we see? What is their potential? Can we explore something more on them? Thanks to, you know, like our Honorable Prime Minister Modi ji for this term Divyanga. He introduced this term. Divyanga meaning divine, Divya, divine body. So why do we have that? Because there is something not really, you know, at ease with them. So Divya Anga, where we have adapted that term to highlight the divine powers. It is just that we are not able to perceive those powers that they have because our perception is limited. They have so many divine powers and we try to, you know, like expand our perspective so that we'll be able to understand them. That is why it is called Divya. And the silver yoga. So this is for the senior citizen. Aging, as we all know, is there a rewind button in life? It is only a fast forward button. We can never press the rewind button, go back. See, I did a mistake when I was 25 years old. Can I go and make something, repair that, and then come back to the now? It is never possible, right? So we just have the fast forward mode in life and living where we just have to keep going. So as we age, what happens is that the wear and tear the body takes and all those years of, you know, working tires us out. Physical ailments, a lot of many other array of problems in the health happening. The main problem is that, you know, once they retire, they have this notion that they are of no use. And, you know, as you age, you become a real child, and that too sometimes an adamant child. So how are we going to address them? So there is a lot of disturbance, suffocation happening in their mind. Half of them is just perceived. They imagine, they just think it is there. And half of it is like because they might have lost a partner. They do not know how to cope up with that, the loneliness, etc., etc. So how do we, you know, like alleviate all this through the yoga therapy schedule? And the other population is the third gender. As you all know, third gender or the transgender, the umbrella term that refers to people whose gender identity is different from what they thought when they were born. And so many social disadvantages. It's real pathetic when we correspond with them, because we have been seeing them over the past decade, because these were the three innovative centers that started, you know, on the same day. The transgender clinic, music therapy and yoga therapy, all of them were started on the same day. The inception of all these three next door, actually, music therapy, yoga therapy, just opposite neighbors. And there was a transgender clinic also where the patients, participants used to come and they used to be referred to. Thanks to Dr. Ambujam. Ma'am, if you are here, thank you, because you truly believed in us. And the support that you have given us from day one is, it means a lot to us. Thank you so much, ma'am. Respecting is something that I have learned from you. How to respect somebody as a human being, how to treat them equal, as an equal, and not, you know, look at them as a dirt. That is something that I have really experienced, you know, being that non-medical person in a medical atmosphere. The way they look at you, you feel, you know, like so humiliated, but it's all down the lane now. So let's not go back to that. The transgender people, lot of social disadvantages for them because of the discrimination and the stigma. They are, you know, like more often pushed to the fringe of the society. So how do we address all these, you know, populations where through yoga therapy, can we address all the problems that they are undergoing? And to the best of our knowledge, you know, all the children with special needs, the silver citizen and transgenders of Pondicherry community are receiving such a kind of a systematized yoga therapy protocol through sessions conducted by a medical university. And to the best of our knowledge, I think this is the first time it is ever happening. And what is the uniqueness? There should be something unique because we claim so much, right? Are we claiming something beyond it? No. Whatever we are claiming is nothing and nothing but the truth. And yoga therapy module that we have created, you know, like has a set of practices that are modified and tailored to suit each and every person. And, you know, the modifications and variations we keep implementing, we keep exploring, we keep trying more and more on them. And then finally, you know, to suit that particular person, we settle down with that particular protocol to suit each individual. That is the greatest challenge in the beginning, because there is, you know, like we didn't have any referrals where we could just go back to and refer. Is there a protocol that has already been worked on or standard protocols or guidelines to follow. There was nothing of that sort for us. So it was all created from scratch, brick by brick, hard, you know, years of work over the past decade, the experiences that has, you know, sort of built it up. Single brick by brick is what I would say. And counseling, I don't know whether it is part of the protocol anywhere else, but yogic counseling and chanting, it is a compulsory part of all our protocols where we take it forward to these, especially these, any group we take it forward to. And the schedule we have devised is very simple. There's no complication at all. It is safe and it is fun-filled, enjoyable to ensure the complete heart, you know, wholehearted compliance from anybody who has this experience. And what we have found is that the group sessions, more the merrier, as we say, you know, group activity is kind of like they have, you know, the peer groups. It gives them a kind of security. They can correspond with them. They can kind of be open with them. There is no animosity. There is no insult there because everybody in that group is like me. And it's not like they are looking at you as if you have come from an external planet, from Mars or some other planet, right? So it's easy for you to correspond with them. Say, for example, in a senior citizen group, all of them are seniors. All of them have their own problems and the peer support that each of them get. And, you know, like ultimately they feel that I'm not the only person who's having this problem. I'm not the only person who's suffering. So there are others who have more problems. So in front of that, my problem is nothing. It is just this much and they are going through so much. So, you know, it is kind of a consolation for them is what, I don't know why, but there is a support, the group support they get. And when they are doing it in this group, there is a kind of, you know, like, looking forward to for the next session. And it's definitely mood elevating and they have a lot of fun, especially, you know, because they feel so lonely and pushed out, not included. Whereas in this group where they are doing it along with their own people, they feel so included and they feel completely at ease. They really enjoy, which is very important. Anything that you enjoy goes to your heart and the benefits will be able to settle in, right? Otherwise, no. So what are the advantages? It has kind of, you know, the therapy schedules over these years kind of renewed and recreated, redefined and enhanced the quality of lives of many of these people belonging to the underprivileged populations, the neglected parts of the society. And they have become so resilient and, you know, they are beginning to accept their limitations. What is the disability that they have? You have to accept it so that the next step could be taken. So that sense of acceptance has come into many of them is what I feel. And the routine chores that they are able to do it with ease and there is no aggression. And the resentment is gone. And they willingly participate now. They are able to come out of their shell, participate in the social activities, which they never used to before. You know, they would just would prefer to be isolated. But now they are willing to come into the society, be a part of the society, making everything, you know, so wholesome. So we initially, you know, faced a lot of obstacles because, like I said, there was no standard protocols that we could follow or, you know, that we could look up to. And everything was started from scratch and we had to explore. It's kind of like a dead end. Sometimes we go and get hit and then we come back, start from the scratch again. Okay, we try something else. So it's like painstaking sometimes. But then the prime motive is not to harm. Ahimsa, as you all know, is the main policy. And persistence, perseverance, patience, I think that has developed within all of us now working with these populations. It has definitely increased in us so that we could, you know, get through all these barriers. definitely man-made barriers. And you know, the other main obstacle that we faced was we would set up the schedules at CITER, and you know, we would wait for them. The hour, you know, whether for the special children or for the senior citizens or for the transgenders. But the problem was that they were dependent on somebody else to come here, to get here for a vehicle, transportation. There were so many other hitches that happened. So we thought about it. So what was the, how could we solve this? So then we decided that instead of making them come to CITER, we would go out. And we started conducting the classes in their schools and their institutions so that they could easily access it. So the schools, you know, Sade and Satya schools, weekly regular yoga sessions are being given there. And Silver Citizen, the Hospice of St. Clooney, and Serene Pelican, who have a tie-up with Mahatma Gandhi for the senior citizens, and the Short Society for the transgenders. And another good thing in SBB is that there is a lot of employment opportunity for the transgenders. They encourage, and even the top supervisor of our block is a transgender. So it's really heartwarming to see that, you know, the inclusiveness that we have at, there's no discrimination. That is another advantage at SBB. And, you know, like our heartfelt gratitude to, again, the management and administration for all this support that they have given us, and for all the organizations who had the trust in us and who have always supported all our activities, the programs, participations, everything innovative. They never had the one inkling of doubt. Will this work? Will we be able to do it? Nothing. When we say, they are more than willing to participate, and which is kind of the motivation for us to reach out more. So what are the impact of these practices? We have so many publications resulting from, you know, the Divyanga Yoga, or just tell me, these are special children. Can you spot any difference? They are all up on stage giving a demonstration. And can you see one teacher standing next to them, holding them or supporting them or guiding them? It is just, I have a mic. I am not even visible in that area. I have a mic. I'm just giving the instruction from a corner, and they are doing all that by themselves. You know, like, that is what the Divyanga is all about. That's it. I don't want to say anything more, but the dedication, the sincerity that, you know, that they show, that is really, really heartwarming. They truly work for, you know, achieving something. That's something very, very motivatory for us. And the Silver Yoga, again, lots of publications coming through. I'm not going into the details. You know very well that our director, Ananda sir, believes in sharing is caring, and all this is already shared. So everything is in the website. If you go there and type for all this, you'll be able to access everything. Third gender, the third transgender. One more study, the pilot RCT is just beginning. We are just going to start over with that. So more coming in with that. What is yoga therapy all about? Again, it is an art, a science. So with each group we meet, with each individual we meet, we learn so many things about what therapy means. So what is the ultimate aim of a therapy? It is just that, you know, like, we have so many techniques, so many tools in yoga. So how do we, you know, like, how do we use our sense of discrimination to choose and pick and empower that particular person using this tool, using this technique? That is what yoga therapy is all about. And how do we do it? Only by experience. You know, like, because we try to radiate the joy and happiness, we try to take it forward to them so that, you know, all those life challenges that they have faced. And when they come into the yoga therapy session, it's quite difficult to break that barrier initially because they are so hard. It is like a hard nut to crack. So it's slowly, like very, very slowly, all that is given out and then they get transformed, they come out. You know, and like Rama Reddy sir's slide now said, less is more. Even in medicine, that same policy goes. So for effective yoga therapy, less is usually more. So we don't need, you know, 20 asanas and 10 pranayamas and blah, blah, blah to go on a schedule, a complete package to be, you know, giving them the benefit. Nothing. Even one technique could create the magic, could, you know, create the miracle in them, the change in them. So that is it. And anything that is pleasant, anything that you enjoy, you know, can touch your heart and benefit could happen. And, you know, like, why do we always, what do you want to be like when we have the, you know, like you sit with yourself, what is it that you remember, you know, the school days, back to the school days, because that is some time when we have enjoyed, it is close to our heart, right? You know, those picnics, those fun filled activities that we used to do with our friends and all those things. So anything that we have enjoyed is always, you know, they are an indelible mark in our hearts. So that is the same with our protocols. We try to make it as joyous and as enjoyable as possible that it leaves a mark on them that they want to do more and more and more. So what are the qualities that are essential in a therapist? If you ask me, I would say cheerfulness, liveliness, and effective communication. Say, for example, I walk into a class now and, you know, hello all, good morning. How are you all? I hope you're all having a very good time. So can we start the yoga therapy session today? I hope that you're all in a good state of mind. Can you sit straight? So how does that sound? Do you think there's going to be any change in that? The moment you walk in and say, you know, hey, how are you all? So can we start? So there should be some life. See, it's like something that doesn't have a life. You are inculcating that energy. You have to give them that energy. You have to be cheerful, you know, like you have to use all your energy to bring that out because it is not just you. You are taking it out to others. So you need to have for yourself and for them also. So communication, the way you do it, it has to be really effective. Otherwise, they will never get motivated to continue with the class. The next time you call them, oh no, I'm not coming into that yoga therapy session. Please don't call me. That is the only reply that they would give. And they would have to be dragged into it. And trust. So how can you bond with them? That you have to earn the trust and love them unconditionally and, you know, create that sense of grounding, stability, and enhance the capacity for their healing. Be a good listener. And when you're doing a class, you know, like maybe there are 15, maybe there are 20, but, you know, with the, by interacting with them over so many days, you please try to remember their names. And give a personal touch. When you're doing the class, you'll be demonstrating. So from there, you could say, hey, auntie, that was really good. Geeta auntie, super, very good. Can you do it a little more? Or, you know, a kid in this special class, a special children's school. Hello, Divya. Yeah, that's really good. Super, Divya. Sharmila, can you do it a bit more? So they really feel included. You know, the personal touch. Makes them feel so warm. And, you know, the next time they want to come into the class. And one very, very important thing that, you know, personally, what I feel is that I will never go and touch them or pull their hand to give the correction. Anybody. Because that is something which makes them so conscious that the next time they do that posture or that technique, they immediately remember what was, you know, what they had not done. So the consciousness makes them stiff, which is not what we want. You keep demonstrating, and you know, they keep looking about, because again, it is a peer group. So they keep looking about, then this correction, they themselves, correct. So self-correction is the best. So maybe if it is too wrong, you could just go and gently, you know, say, hey, that's really good, but can you do it a little like this? Just, you know, in a nice way, but don't make them conscious. That is something from my personal experience that I have felt. And empathy, they never want your sympathy. Please do not sympathize with them. They need you to be empathetic, because you have to be in their shoes to really understand what is it that they are going through, what are the problems that they are facing. Because, you know, like being you, you cannot really perceive what that is. So you have to really be empathetic and, you know, be able to understand what is it that their skill is, what is it that they have as a limitation. We need to understand that, and we need to pick that up so that we can fine tune that part for that particular person. And again, so what is the philosophy that goes behind all this yoga therapy scheme? One, as a trademark, you all know, pushing the tensions away. So the letting go practice, as you all know, the shake and throw, which is very, very useful. I have seen that in every place, any group that I am up to, you know, like especially the so-called normal people, you know, like the elite people, wherever you go, you are making a presentation, and then, you know, after some time, you very obviously see in their faces, oh my God, is the tea break going to come up now? Are they serving tea there? So what is our lunch going to be? Ah, I can smell that, you know, I think it's a bread sandwich. So, you know, like the sense of boredom is very visible in their face, and you just make them stand up and do this shake and throw. And then suddenly, you know, the whole the hall is charged with energy, and they are smiling, and you know, they come up to you. So the moment you perceive that they are not with you, so this is something, you know, a trick that we do. Go and make them get up, shake and throw all your tensions away. You will get your tea, you will get your lunch. Don't worry about that. So come to the present moment. So that's kind of the first thing. And stretching at all levels of existence, because they are so tight because of all these, you know, the insults, the harsh feelings that from others that they have got so many years has tightened them up. So you have to slowly stretch. So the gross level stretching is going to stretch the other levels of existence. You know, the psychology, the adaptability, the quality of resilience, you're able to bounce back. How is it? Because if you're stiff, you cannot bounce. You just throw it, you're going to fall down with a thud. So you have to bounce back. So the quality of, you know, stretching is very, very important. That is focused upon, and the posture. A person's mental acumen could be very well found, you know, just by correction of the posture, you can correct so many things in them. And extended exhalations using the sounds, using nada. Any of the sessions with these specialized groups, it is a very, very noisy session. We say, please close the door. It is going to be noisy for the next hour. So if it is a disturbance, we are sorry, but we can't help it. It is going to be that. There will be a lot of noise, you know, to vent out, to sublimate. There's no other way other than all these funny, funny sounds or noise and the nada that we use. So because the repetition of certain sound patterns has a real calming effect. It attenuates the limbic activity, as we all know, the nerve system and the psyche. So that has to happen only with the nada. They suppressed and they have regressed and suppressed, and they hold back so many emotions within. So it has to be sublimated. It has to be, you know, ventilated out. So how can we do that? Only through this. And help enable attain the sukha sthanam. So what are the yoga techniques? Just a few, maybe. Yes, I think I have some more time. I would just show a few techniques as to how we use the nada and how the variations are applied, you know, what are the modifications, just a few sample techniques I would just show. So to start with, I have to be adjusting the screen. Yes, I think you'll be able to see. So the Thala Kriya, it is like usually what we do is like breathe in, stretch, and then breathing out, come back. This is how we do. But for these special populations, as I went out, how do we do is one, we make them just sway, a simple movement. You remember yesterday, Devsena ma'am was talking about all that music, that bhava, and how it can, you know, the simple movements, the bhava can lighten the emotions of a person, right? Ramesh Bijlani sir also was talking about that, you know, just dance, sway with the music. So that is the philosophy that goes behind. Thala Kriya, as you breathe in, just stretch your hands up and, you know, just sway like a palm tree moving in the wind. Just sway and move. Just move. A simple movement. You feel really good because it is not so difficult at all. And the other thing that we would do in the same Kriya is when we come down, we would do it with a oosh. Say for example, breathing in, we go stretch up and in. So if you can see, you know that again, the venting out, the letting go happening at various levels. And you know, the Veera Asana that we do, normally we do it like this, but for these populations, how the variation that we would apply is, you know, like stretching the foot ahead. I'm not going into the breathing sequence and all, just the posture and the position, and mainly, you know, for the how we modify it. That's the main important purpose of what we are doing. So stretch your right leg forward and bend your knee, breathing in, stretch your arms up, looking up. We have to utter Har Har Mahadev, you know, like from the Navi. So if you're all ready, you could do it with me. Whether we hear it or not, it's okay. You could do it with me. Are you all ready? Thumbs up. Yes. Good. So as you breathe in, stretch up and look up and start. Har Har Mahadev. Har Har Mahadev. Har Har Mahadev. And slowly bring your hands down, straighten your knees, and you know, stretch your other leg forward. The same thing, bend your knee, stretch up, looking up. Three more times, if you're all ready, breathing in, up, start. Har Har Mahadev! Har Har Mahadev! Har Har Mahadev! Slowly stretch down and straighten forward. So you know that energy that is created, I'm sure you'll be able to feel that energy right now. And a few more things I think we'll be doing from the sitting. I hope I'm adjusting the screen correct. Yes. Yes. So the Titli, it's kind of a butterfly because of all the caging. You know, like they have all these suppressed emotions. So just to relieve that, to open them out as if the bird is coming out of the cage. So as they breathe in, they just open up, simple opening up. And then breathing out, it's kind of, they bring together. Breathing in. Breathing out. Breathing in, breathing out. And you know, this particular posture that we do here, tightening up, and you're holding yourself. Like sir was saying, you know, the hormonal secretion, oxytocin release. So it is kind of like you're hugging yourself. All the worry is gone, so it is okay. And then, you know, after that self-assurance, yes, everything is fine. And then you open up, open your wings, open up and, you know, like stretch out, opening your shoulders, which is going to open out your confidence, the sense of confidence, your esteem, your, you know, the self-respect, it is all going to flourish so much more with this simple, you know, technique. And Meru Priya, have you ever seen a mountain walk? Which is what we are going to do now, okay? So coming up slowly into the Meru Asana. And the mountain is going to walk. You can make your own sounds. Moving forward and then moving backward. Moving forward, moving backward. So did you ever imagine a mountain could walk? So that is how we could, you know, like make, just implement a few things, techniques that we do, just a little loophole in that, create a, you know, channelize it in a different way. That's it. And, you know, Paschimottana and the Purvottana. If you say you are going to do the forward bending and the backward bending, say, for example, in a group of special children, they are not going to understand what a forward bend means and what a backward bend means. So how do you make them do this? How do you make it, you know, simple? So what we would do is, are you able to see? Okay. So what we would do is, you know, like the boating, there is a song that goes in Tamil Nadu when the fishermen are, you know, going fishing. They have to be going against the ocean waves. And they sing a song to make it light, to make it, you know, easy. Elelo, Ailasa. So that's it. Elelo, Elelo, Ailasa. Elelo, Ailasa. So the same, you know, the word, what we use is, when we move forward, I would say Elelo. And when we move back, you would say Ailasa. Are you all ready? Yes. So can we do this, you know, forward, backward? If you're all ready, ready? Stretch up once. And Elelo, bless up. Elelo, I 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 bless up. Elelo. It's kind of, you know, like they really enjoy all this. So wherever all these, you know, sounds could be given, that really helps to, you know, the technique is done, the forward bend is done, the backward bend is done. If you tell them technically, this is Paschimottanasana, go and catch hold of your big toe and then stretch down. I don't know whether that kind of a technicality would reach them. But when you do this, Elelo, Ailasa, we don't do, the class is not complete. So it's kind of like that. They start enjoying. And the next one is the Nava boat. We could do it in two different ways depending on the population that we are reaching up to and depending on the mood of the day, depending on their mood, what we perceive. So one would be, you know, like you could just make them sing a song saying, you know, like we all know the nursery rhyme, row, row, row a boat gently down the stream. So when this is the tailbone balancing, the Naga Asana. Right? So we are doing the tailbone balancing asana to have activation of so many aspects. I'm not going into the benefits of the tailbone balancing postures, right? So the same thing is happening now in a fun way. You just have to do it, that's it, okay? So one, the first one we are going to do, row, row, row a boat. I'm sure you have all done your nursery classes and I'm sure you all know this rhyme, right? So please come along with me, coming into the Navasana position. If you're ready, row, row, row a boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. Row, row, row a boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 life is but a dream. So the movement, it is up to you, right? You row or you, you know, move sideways, whatever it is, but the tailbone balance is achieved. That's it. And the other one, which is more funny, is like to get all again the suppressions out. You know, you throw a tantrum, you cry it out, and then you throw all these stuff outside. So how you do is like the same both posture, the same tailbone. You just shake all your body parts, shake, and you cry way loud like a baby. And slump. So, you know, like all those, whatever is suffocating, it is let out, it is vented out, it is sublimated with all these simple, it may look funny, it may look meaningless, but what is the main purpose here? To have them do it, to get the benefit for them. So once they start enjoying, it is real, real good. Okay, and then last but not the least, the Chatushpada, where we would be doing all the cat and the dog and everything as per their choice. So it will be meow, boo, boo, wow, wow. Or, and then somebody said, you know, like we were doing it in class and somebody said crow. And then I started doing like everybody doing ka, ka, ka. And then you know what happened? A little boy came up to me and he said like this. He never had the power of speech. So he would just act out. So he said, he called me like this and showed me out of the window. There was a crow there and said, crow can only do this. How can it go on all fours like an animal? And then it hit me, oh my God, the so-called normals are so senseless. Whereas this child could understand, I was doing some movement in a wrong way, right? So after all those animal, you know, letting out the animal qualities from us through, you know, this kriya, where we just go around crawling like a baby, crawling like, you know, all fours, and letting out all those animal instincts from within us, the basal instincts. And then you become what you are in this birth, the human being. So sitting quietly in Vajrasana, the Om Pranayama, as you breathe in, giving a good stretch, breathing out. And all the sessions that we give here, the pranava pranayama is done from shavasana. If we see, a lot of studies have been done from a sitar, you know, like proving the benefits of doing pranava from shavasana, attenuating the limbic activity and calming the person down. So we follow the same at sitar. So pranava is given in shavasana for most of them. So what is the reward that we get for all this? Can you see the beautiful smiles on their faces? That is the biggest reward. Is there anything more when they come and tell us, you know, like this is it, that is it, I was able to do this, I was able to do that. And the changes you perceive over these years, the transformation that you see, can you ask for anything more? And this is something which is very close to my heart and I have to share this. If you can see, this is a boy who is autistic and diagnosed with ADHD. And you know what, hyperactive ADHD. He will not stay 1 minute in one place. He's just running around and the focus is never there. So we have competitions, the Pondicherry Yogasana Association every year conducts competitions and there is a special category for the special children here in the competition. And they choose the techniques that they want to do. All of them, they fight with me, they choose the techniques. And this particular boy, Pugarendi, he chose this technique. I told him, Vanda Kanna, I'm sorry, no need. Let us do something else. He was very adamant and he said, because I knew that he would never be able to stand, you know, with his balance in that posture. So then he said, no, he was very adamant. I said, like, okay, let him do it. And then up on stage he came. And if you can see here, the posture is not so perfect, but he stood there. Even after we said, relax, he didn't let go. There was no shake. He was just standing there till the whole, you know, the posture was, till we told them to really shook him to relax. And if you can see, I am happier than him. He is a real yogi. Can you see any reaction in his face? Nothing, right? So I am happiest because after he came out, I just asked him, how did you do it? Because in class, you never did it. How did you do it? He said, like a tree. I just showed him a tree and said that does a tree move? So when you're doing that tree posture, you could not move. You should not move. You just be there. He said, like, I was a tree there and that's it. So what else is asana? To be. So he has understood that. That's the significance which, you know, the Divya children are. And these smiles, can you see? Unbeatable, right? Just reaches you out immediately. So many times in life, you know, struggles are what we need to make us strong. But do we realize that? I don't know. You know, like all these special populations that we have been talking about, the children with special needs, all these senior citizens, then neglected, you know, like from their houses, whatever it is, individual problems, and then the transgenders, all of them have something in common. The social stigma that goes with it, the kind of rejection from the society, the non-acceptance, all of this, you know, like makes them, the insult, you know, makes them feel just cringe and go within, build a real hard cocoon around themselves, like how the butterfly does, just a hard cocoon. They are inside, safe inside their cocoons. That's it. I'm inside me and I'm safe. I don't need these insults. So they kind of get isolated. But after yoga therapy, they get that energy from some place. They are able to, you know, gather that, and the transformation happens, and they slowly break out of that, the cocoon that they have built around, to become that beautiful butterfly. And that is the miraculous moment. And we have seen thousands, I mean, at least hundreds of such miracles here. Because we cannot help them. See, if a butterfly has to come out of the cocoon, it has to make the effort to come out. If we try to poke the cocoon to help the butterfly come, we think we are helping, but in reality, we are not helping. The butterfly will not be strong. It will become weak and then it will die immediately. So what is our role as a yoga therapy, therapist? We just need to give them what could be given, and the impetus is given, and the energy they use to become strong, and they break out, shatter all those barriers. And then, you know, one day they flower out and open their wings and become that beautiful, beautiful, colorful butterflies. If you can see, all these are my colorful butterflies here. So this is something which is very, very close to my heart. I asked for strength and God gave me difficulties to make me strong. I asked for wisdom and God gave me problems to solve. And it goes on. This is a poem by Hazrat Inayat Khan, which is real, real. I just love that. And in conclusion, Saitar of SBV, we try to, you know, empower the underserved, economically backward sections, the neglected sections of the society who do not have access to yoga. So we, through our outreach programs, outreach activities, we go out to them, we reach out to them, helping them to have an independent living, with confidence and self-respect, holding their head high and say, hey, I am what I am. You accept me as I am. I will not change. So that's the kind of, you know, transformation that happens. And we are happy when we see that transformation happening in them. So you all know why yoga is an increasingly popular choice now for such above normal. I will definitely say we are the so-called normals. The children and these people, because of all their sufferings and the insults, they have something beyond what we have. So they are the above normal populations to reconnect with wellness and joy. So that is what yoga therapy is all about. And we are fortunate to have had that opportunity to be able to, reach out and to be able to keep doing that kind of work here. And just one thought to ponder to you all, I'm asking you, don't you think that we owe it to them? It's for us to decide, the choice is ours. So thank you so much for the patient listening, especially after Rama Reddy sir's, the talk and yes. So after all that colorful and, humorous presentation with so much of content, after that, I had my own doubts. After such an effective, presentation, what is it you are going to do? You're just going to, it's going to be dull, drab and boring. But then that's it. Whatever it is, the job is done. So thank you so much for your patience. This is something which is, again, very, very close to our hearts. We are very, very passionate about these special populations because work we do with them is so valuable. It is something that we can never equate. The feeling, the sense of satisfaction that we get, we can never equate it to anything else. That is the reward, the sense of satisfaction, the tripti that we get. So contentment. Thank you so much. Santosha.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meena, for that very beautiful overview of the outreach programs and the focus of CITER, and also the sharing of some of the practices we use, especially with the children with special needs. And whenever you share that story of the kid with autism who was able to become a tree, I think it is very inspirational for all of us that we need to keep in mind what do we want to become. And the sankalpa of what we want to become will enable us to become that. So I think it's very important, and I'm sure that our participants have got a very beautiful overview of the heartfelt work going on here in multidimensional aspects, transforming so many lives. And the heart and soul that Meena puts into her work is highly commendable, and always a pleasure to see that dedication that is there. So I'd like to request any of the panelists to say a few words. We'll keep it short because we've gone way over time, and Meena's way into Brahma Muhurta if she's not careful. So yes, please. Rama Reddy sir, welcome you, sir.
So great, madam. Jnana and Abhyasa, both are given in equal proportion by God to you. You are just not a yoga therapist, but you are a great teacher. For our Godavari people, they say that the cultural capital of Andhra is Rajahmundry. Similarly, what I feel is, CITER is the center for teaching, I feel. As if it is infective, you are almost as great as Bhavanani sir in teaching. People say that, sir says that sharing is caring. But in law, even a single word like R and AND also matters. Here, sharing and the caring, not only knowledge sharing, but also caring. As a PhD scholar, I have experienced that one from you. And when I asked you, Anuloma Viloma Pranayama is not in our Gita Nanda tradition, is it not? How to get that one? You yourself practically did it and gave the video to me. So that's it. That is the dedication you have. And really, it is the proof of pudding. It is really the evidence base that such people like mentally retarded or disabled people, nobody will take for the care. You have a lot of transformation. Really wonderful, that one. And also another thing is, you have said about the touching. Somehow you avoid that one to make them feel not anxious. It has got another dimension also, boundary issues. When not with the mentally retarded children, but other people, they develop so much reverence towards the therapist that sometimes it creates even problems. So we have to be very careful as far as that issue also. We are very fortunate, madam. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. All credits again to that person sitting right there with the beard. I hope there's nobody else in the panelist with the beard, right?
We are talking of beard.
Oh, sorry. No. I'm talking of you. Bharata, please shave your beard.
Really, really nice. Anything, Shailaja, Sangeeta, Devasana, yes, you're most welcome. Sangeeta, yes, please. See you next time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Meena. Such a wonderful presentation, filled with a lot of facts and inspiration. And first of all, it was so wonderful to have such a comprehensive overview, because to see the history and then the content and the results all in one presentation is wonderful. I'm so happy we're recording this and we can keep it as a document so that we can use it to share this work. And particularly, I think it's very important so that we can send it to all of the people in our network who work in organizations and institutions and who may include such a model. Because a lot of us who are not affiliated with an institution may not have the possibility of offering these classes free of charge. It's not always possible. And I think that that's such a fantastic, fantastic gift, actually. And so if, and this is a call to action to all institutions and hospitals, clinics that see this presentation and know that there's such a model that can be adopted, with due respect, of course, and credit and all, to incorporate this, because there's so many therapists, there's so many yoga practitioners who are trained, you know, properly, who can contribute to the community they live in. And sometimes they just don't have the means. So this is really also to reach the top figures, to open up to such a possibility, because it's a gain for everyone anyway. We know that prevention and applying the teachings of yoga to prevention and salutogenesis may seem like an investment at first, but will eventually save the government so much money in care. And so, you know, I think this is an important, I'll be happy to share this presentation with people whom I know who can incorporate this work into their clinics and hospitals. So thank you so much for this. Thank you very, very much.
That means a lot, Sangeeta, coming from you.
Thank you.
Devasana, miss, you would like to say something?
Namaste. Again, very well done, always. So no doubt. And your work, it's really like different groups, actually. Like in our Rama Reddy Garu's presentation, as he said, the one thing that this work, it works, actually. For everybody, the yoga is works, actually. Amaji says, whether you think or not, it's happening inside. That's what she said, because when we started, we are not at all really thinking what is happening, what we are learning even. So Amaji is telling, whether you are thinking or not, it's working, actually. So like that, it works for everybody. All the practices works. But nowadays with the research, you're going like this group has to have practices like that. But the yoga works, whether the people works, we don't know. because people is already, even the so-called the normal, even as you mentioned, we don't think some of the things are like a normal people. So with the normal people, even very, very different. As we say, like we have the five fingers, whether all five the same, we always think like the people different. So already normal, even different, each and every person. In that, you are working all different groups. That's really a great work. Like you are a Divyanga, that's really very special actually. So special, as we call the special kids. I remember very well when you bring the groups in the competition, they used to really chant the sutras even very easily. They chant Yogaha Chitta Vritti Nirodaha. They go very easily. I remember our community college, you remember all the like so-called coming to the nearly middle group. They are, turned over than the teenagers. They cannot even chant Yogaha Karmasri Kaushalam or even the Tatakshiyate Prakashavaram. That and all, I had to make them to like by heart it. I had to go them like chanting the like kindergarten groups. I'll just tell them to repeat the words like that to get them at least few, that sutras. So, but they were the Divyanga, the group, the special kids, they were so nicely chanting in our competition. I remember very well. So you make them to think and get the essence. As we are going discussing yesterday in the character, that they will get the essence, they will change that character, they come to the character, they live in the character so that they can bring the essence out. As our Bijlani Bhaiyaji telling that with the emotional thing, all really, it's very related how you are working and make them to transfer to be in that, as our Dr. Satchel, to be in that. So it's all really making the essence to bring in them. So great work again. Very, 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 very nice. So you gave them the life that the others
can see
in them. That's very nice. Thank you so much.
Thank you, miss.
Thank you.
What happened? All the silence suddenly?
No, my mic was muted and I didn't realize it. So I asked if Shri Bharata Shailaja wants to make any comments. I will have a few moments. Yes, please.
I'll just say something very quickly. I actually want to say something. I just wanted to tell, I'm just completely blown away by, you know, the work that you do, and really huge, huge respect for the work that you do. And Saiter sounds like a really amazing place. And I feel if I had somebody gave me a wish, there would be like a Saiter in every town. And of course, we need a Dr. Meena to run the place as well. So we have to find a way to clone you. But the work that you do, you know, Saiter, as you know, their outreach programs, your principals, and it's also, I think, a lot of credit to, like you keep saying, to the management and administration of Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, who have given you the fuel to go ahead and do all of these things. So all of that really stands out. And I really like one line that you talked about when we talked about your special needs children, about how it is we who are so limited in our perspective, and that we have to expand our perspective to be able to see them in their potentiality. So I thought that was really beautiful and something all of us should think about, because we are so used to thinking that we are so normal and everybody who's not like us, you know, something's wrong with them, right? So it's good for us to really look into ourselves and expand on our perspective and be able to be more inclusive. So many words that you used I really liked, you know, so many words about inclusiveness, about connection, about wholesomeness, about personal touch, and I really like that above normal population. I don't think I've heard that one before.
Thank you,
it's
thank you, really
beautiful, Dr. I mean, just huge respect for what you do. And like, I just want to say also that you can never be dull or drab or boring or any presentation that you do, because you have too much of a vibrant, radiant energy that can never be dull or drab or boring. And truly, I feel a teacher is known by their students. So truly, I mean, you are such a reflective student of Dr. Ananda's, you know, a guruship or teachership or whatever. You just make him so proud. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Shailaja. Means a lot.
A quick word to say thank you so much for the enthusiasm and the inspirational presentation. Very, very informative. The one theme I wanted to just acknowledge and highlight is the theme of respect for you in all the clinical services, the different population groups. What came through repeatedly was the emphasis on respect and uplifting the potential of the individual. And that was so, so inspiring. So thank you.
Just wanted thank you. Thank you, Bharata. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And of course, it was a joke, huh? Shaving your beard off.
For a long time.
Namaste, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So in one presentation you have covered, as Sangeeta ma'am said, you covered the history and the present and the future also. Actually, it was really a nice presentation. And what we are doing, and once you are saying that, then only I realized how so many things we are doing. So that's the thing I have in my mind, in the back of my mind. But really, it was an amazing thing. No? But we keep on going these things. And now we have three aspects we are focusing. We can able to extend it a lot with the guidance of sir and you, ma'am, sure. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Daya.
Thank you so much, Daya. It's really true that often, you know, we don't realize what we are doing because we are doing it so regularly. And then you have to put it out and you're like, oh my God, we're actually doing this, because, you know, you forget it, it becomes your routine. Yes. And so it is very important to have this. Bala, we'd like to have some comments from you.
I have seen those kids, special kids with ma'am sometimes in Sunday school. I know what how she takes class with them. I have experienced many times with her. I've been there with sir, Meena ma'am, because initially when starting the site, so how it flown now. I miss, many times I have expressed it also, I miss part of Saitar in many ways actually, but I'm already also in a different part. So that's, and ma'am, whatever you're doing is, I, to my knowledge also, no one is doing, you know, no one is even doing it. Even they have a special school, but I don't know anyone is doing these kind of uplifting things to those kind of things. So you are something special and you are unique in many ways. And yes, we will be there to support you to do a lot of things, and hope this community will be recognized by you in a different way, and they will play a key role in uplifting the world in future also. So thank you for the seva. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bala. And all credits, of course, because we have this opportunity to be able to do it. Otherwise, how do you think that we will be able to reach out? So because of sir, thanks to sir, and Sugathan sir approached, and then, you know, it just happened. Everything worked out one after the other. So again, credits to, that's it. Thank you. And you are always a part of CITER. You are never out of CITER, Bala. You're always a part of team CITER. Any day, every day, you are team CITER.
See, I understand Bala's feeling, but what I always say is, there's a time when the baby eagle is ready to fly. The cage, the nest may be a very nice place to be, but then it is the job of the mother eagle to make that baby eagle go out and fly, because eagles are meant to fly, not stay in the nest forever. And similarly with CITER, when people are ready, they have to go out and they have to create, replicate in their own way these models in different hospitals. And being a medical doctor, you have that opportunity to again bridge. And I'm so happy because also we can say our placement cell is working well. All our alumni are placed in different places. So it's, if everybody was still at CITER, we couldn't claim that. So I think it's good. And anybody out there who needs, people to come and fill up your spaces in hospitals with yoga therapists, we have a lot of people we can recommend, and we'll be happy to recommend that it happens all over the world. So anybody listening, well, there are people who are willing to do it. And I always say, if I cannot be places, now I have a team who can be there. And I think that's important, because it cannot be a one-man show. It has to be a teamwork. And that is one of the hallmarks of CYTER, is it's always a teamwork. I think it's very important. So we will conclude today. And I must say that as Dr. Meena was making a presentation, I have been revising my own presentation, because many of the slides have overlap. And so I'm going to be doing. She didn't know what slides I was using. I didn't know what slides she was using. But that's how life is. And I'm like half a dozen slides I'm going to have to replace tonight for my tomorrow.
Thank God I did it today and you are doing it tomorrow.
Otherwise,
I would have had to do that work.
Anyway, so we wish to thank everyone for being with us. You all amazing. And each and everyone is amazing. And we have two more days of amazing sessions to come. We have Bharata presenting tomorrow. And we have Shailaja and Dr. Manjunath on the next day. So, just lot of good stuff coming up. So stay tuned, be with us, and watch this space. Om Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinah, Sarve Santu Niramaya, Sarve Bhadrani Pashyantu, Ma Kaschid Dukkha Bhag Bhavet. Om Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu, Sarve Janah Sukhino Bhavantu. Om Shantihi, 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 Om. Dhanyavadaha, danke, merci, shukriya, nandri, vanakkam.